Shalom. Oh, there it is. Shabbat Shalom. It's so good to see everybody. This concert is a long time in coming. We're not streaming yet. We're live? Okay, so again, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. To those that are here in person and to those who are joining us via live stream, it is so good to have you here. This concert began its preparation or its the thinking of it months, I would say probably, 6 to 8 months before Lilli's special birthday. So we were all ready. We were ready to go, and we had it scheduled. It was a few weeks after her special birthday, and then COVID-19, pandemic, everything, and like many other things, during this period of time, things got canceled, things got pushed back, things got rescheduled. So we have the opportunity tonight to roll back time. This is a rare thing, right? We most of the time you cannot control these things, but for tonight, we are going to roll back time and celebrate the special birthday. And I want you to join with me to do this with Yom Huledet. Everyone say Yom Huledet. Sameach. And we're going to sing this, okay? Yom Huledet Sameach. Yom Huledet Sameach. Yom Huledet Sameach. Yom Huledet Sameach. Happy birthday, Lilli. Happy birthday. So, I wish I had the opportunity to celebrate certain birthdays over again, but Lilli, this is something pretty amazing. So, meanwhile, back now a year and a half plus later, we have the opportunity to have a rare listen to the Chicago Bassoon Trio. And I don't know about you, but it's not often I get to hear bassoon by itself or in an ensemble. I've heard them in many different kind of ensembles, where in some Baroque ensembles, classical ensembles, where things have been transcribed, but this is a rare opportunity, and so I'm thrilled that at some point Jim and Beth were talking. They came across each other. They met each other, and it came out that Beth was a part of this ensemble, and he thought, what a great opportunity to bring music that we don't always hear to North Shore Congregation Israel in honor of that special birthday that we're celebrating today a little late. And so, it is a great honor. Thank you, Jim, for doing this for our community. It's a great honor for me to welcome the Chicago Bassoon Trio for us this evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you all for joining us tonight, and we're really honored to be part of your celebration of your belated birthday or your younger birthday or whatever you... So we're happy to be here and celebrate a birthday with Lilli and with Jim. We're the Chicago Bassoon Trio. We have Elizabeth Heller over here, known as Beth. And this is Sue Nigro on my other side, and she'll be switching between the contrabassoon and the bassoon. And she will tell you about the contrabassoon later. Our next piece is by a very hardly known composer named Franz Xaver Wolff. He played many different wind instruments, but mostly played clarinet in a military band. He composed a few chamber works in his lifetime, but all that's left for us to find now is a bassoon concerto and this bassoon trio that we're going to play for you. He was born shortly before Mozart died, so we think that his music reminds us of the Mozart bassoon concerto and Beethoven's early symphonies. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next piece is by Jeffrey Hartley, who was a bassoonist. He actually studied engineering. He lived from 1906. He died in 1992. He was an English composer and actually engineer, mathematician. He taught math but continued playing bassoon in local orchestras throughout his life. He actually played under Sir Colin Davis in the Chelsea Opera Group, so I thought that was pretty impressive. He also composed chamber music, including this suite. He also has a fantasy on a British tea song, which we play with our, when we play a quartet, which we sometimes do as well. I noticed that Lynette Pralle forgot to introduce herself, so she's the one playing. she played first on that. I will say that we are an equal opportunity employer here. We all switch around who plays first, who plays second, who plays third, and contra. We only have one contra player, so. But she's very special to us. So, so anyway, Jeffrey Hartley, our next piece. Thank you.
Bye. The next piece on our program is from Suite Pictures in an Exhibition, which was a suite originally of 10 pieces plus 5 recurring promenades, which was written for piano in 1874 by the Russian composer Modest Mussorgsky. It was not published until 1886, though, which was 5 years after his death. And this was in an edition by his colleague, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov. In 1922, the French composer Maurice Ravel produced a very fine orchestration of this work, which has really become the best known version of it. This evening, we will perform 5 movements of this piece, skillfully arranged for 2 bassoons and a contrabassoon by Lynette, Pralle. The first thing we're gonna do is a promenade. This is a piece that does recur several other times in the suite, and it depicts a person strolling through an art exhibition. The second piece we're gonna do is Il Vecchio Castillo, the old castle, and this is a description of a medieval Italian castle where a troubadour is singing. In the orchestral version, this is portrayed by an alto saxophone, but here obviously by a bassoon. Third one we're gonna do is called Tuileries, or the Children's Quarrel After Games. And this is a representation of an avenue in the Tuileries Garden in Paris, which is inhabited by a swarm of children and their various nurses and nannies. Then comes Bidlo, which is a Polish word for cattle. And this is a depiction of a Polish cart on enormous wheels drawn by 2 oxen, which approaches quietly from a distance, passes by at a louder volume, and then finally recedes back to where it came. And then we're going to finish up with the Great Gate of Kiev, which is a representation of the city gates in this massive Russian style with a cupola that's shaped like a Slavonic helmet. I just realized I didn't use the microphone, but I'm a retired school teacher, so I guess you could hear me.
Thank you.
Ah, thank you very much. Our next piece, or two pieces, well, from the Six Trios by Julius Weissenborn. Now, Weissenborn was born in 1837. He died in 1888. He was a German bassoonist and composer, teacher. He was principal bassoonist of the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra for 30 years. He also taught at the Leipzig Conservatory. He was principally known for his pedagogical works, The Practical Method for Bassoon and Bassoon Studies, which virtually all bassoonists, including the three of us, have played ad whatever nauseam. But he's actually very well known for his pedagogical works. But he also wrote these very nice trios, so we're going to play two of them for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
of my very favorite things. I forgot to tell you last time about the contrabassoon, but I probably don't have to say much more about it now because you heard it already. It's like the clarinet and the bass clarinet. It's the bassoon and the contrabassoon. It's an octave lower. It plays basically the notes on the bottom half of the piano. It goes all the way down to the bottom, except I'm missing that very last note. And the highest note I can play is the middle C. So it's just basically the bottom part of the piano. And this instrument is just used basically to extend the range of the bassoon family and to sort of augment some of the sounds it can make. So if anybody wants to come up and look at it afterwards, I'd be more than happy to do show and tell and tell you whatever you'd like to know about my favorite instrument. The other favorite thing I get to talk about is my very favorite composer, Scott Joplin, whose pieces we're going to play now. Scott Joplin, contrary to what most people might think, is not a modern composer. He was born right after the Civil War in 1868 in Northeast Texas. And his father was actually a newly freed slave. His mother was a freeborn African-American woman. He's noted mostly for his numerous ragtime compositions. And as a youth, he actually taught himself to play the piano and the banjo. And then he subsequently received music lessons, classical music lessons, from a German immigrant named Julius Weiss, who sort of took him under his wing and showed him how to write music. He later went to music school at George Smith College and began publishing and playing music. And he appeared in the 1893 Columbia World Exposition here in Chicago, which is where ragtime really was born. Oddly enough, during his lifetime, he really was not receiving of the recognition he deserved. He died in New York City right after World War I. He's been dead over 100 years, and was buried in a pauper's grave with no marker on it. He was basically like Mozart, he died poor. And all of a sudden, in the 1970s, he became famous when some of his music was featured in the movie The Sting. That's when people first heard it. And all of a sudden, there's this big Scott Joplin craze, and everybody wanted to know what he was up to. He had been dead for 75 years, unfortunately, poor guy. But he did receive some recognition after the fact, because in 1974, ASCAP, which is the American Association of Composers, Arrangers, and Performers, finally placed a bronze marker on his gravestone. In 1976, he got a Pulitzer Prize, and in 1983, the U.S. Post Office issued a stamp in his honor. And just as a sidebar, a couple years ago when I was in New York City, I had a couple free hours, so I thought I would go and visit him in the cemetery. I managed to find out he was buried in St. Michael's Cemetery in Queens, which is where most of the 9/11 first responders are buried. So I thought, well, okay. So I took the subway and the bus and I walked and I got over there and I had no idea where he was. So I went into the cemetery office and talked to the woman in there. I said, excuse me, can you tell me where I find Scott Joplin? Figuring she'd probably have to look it up or whatever. She says, come over here to the window. You see that big, huge pile of flowers about a quarter of a mile down that road? That's where he is. So I thought, okay, great, I'll get down there and have a few quiet moments with him. Well, it was me, the gravestone, the flowers, and about 150 other people. He gets a lot of visitors. People come to see him all the time. So he's enjoying the fame now that he unfortunately never had during his lifetime. So we've got three short little ragtime pieces to play today, which again were arranged by a resident composer here, Lynette Pralle. The first one is Cleofa, which is just a full-blown, rollicking, ragtime tune. The second one is Bethina, which is a very special piece. It's thought of as a classical ragtime waltz. And it was his first copyrighted piece after the death of his second wife, Freddie, and it's dedicated to her memory. And the last one we're going to play is a Maple Leaf Rag, which was written either in 1897 or 1898. It was a very early piece of his, one of his most famous ones, and it was dedicated to the Maple Leaf Club in Sedalia, Missouri, where he used to play piano. Thank you.
Thank you. So I have to ask, is the contra literally twice as long as the regular, so just
yes,
twisted?
Yes. 18 feet 4 inches, 19 2 inches.
That's how it gets to the extra.
Yeah.
Because if the organ, the organ pipes work that way,
right? Exactly.
You have the 16 foot and the 8 foot, yeah.
Right. My lowest seat is 16 seat.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah,
that's great. I grew up playing clarinet, alto clarinet, and bass clarinet.
Oh, really?
So,
oh,
okay. I started on piano and then did clarinet before I sang. Singing was what my ultimate instrument was. In fact, I have a good friend who was a concert bassoonist, and she became a phenomenal singer, and she's a cantor out in
really?
San Diego.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. It's a hard instrument. Now, do you all obsess over the reeds the way the oboe players do?
Not quite so bad.
Not quite as bad. You don't want to be lumped in with those oboes.
No.
The
reeds last longer. They take a longer to make, but they last longer.
Theirs do.
Yeah. So ours can last long. Theirs last concert, maybe half a concert.
Yeah. Well, I had a good friend in New Orleans who was a phenomenal oboist for the at the time the New Orleans Symphony before. Fred Corman. And he would talk about his reeds and oh my God.
Yeah.
It just
that's all
was,
I knew.
There was something.
I like that.
There was something. Yeah, I mean the jokes about that are sort of like Viola's jokes, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, it's so wonderful. Thank you so much for being here and for.
Thank you. It's really nice. It's a wonderful place to play.
Yeah. Oh, this room is.
This room is
big.
Yeah, we had the Black Oak Ensemble here, and
well, that's a program for them.
And they asked us if they could record here. So their latest recording. Their latest recording is going to be all done here.
Really?
Yeah, on Sedilla. Sedilla Records.
Yeah,
it's a great space. But we have to make sure for those kinds of things that we turn off all the blowers and motors.
Yeah.
But the room is, you look at how it's made. It's made of, wood, so it.
Yeah, so it's out. And it's got the four holes up there that hold the bass stuff too. Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's a fun room to be in for music. We've had a number of different. We've had the Lincoln Trio here. We've had a number of groups in here. Then it's we've had guitar and violin.
Oh, okay.
Adam Levin and his. I mean, they were one. But not after right before the concert, he was featured on in front of the major guitar magazine. I forgot the. Well, it's one of the. I mean, very few people get featured on the cover, and even
right.
You got.
I found this backstage at a concert.
great, that's awesome.
That's oboe reeds, right?
Yeah, oboes are.
They're on a rise for a reason.
I used to shape my reeds on clarinet, but I never made my own reeds.
Yeah,
well, it's much easier. I mean, you have some work that you have to do on any reed that you get on the clarinet, but it's not that hard. And if you make a mistake, it's not that expensive to just.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Or at least it wasn't. I haven't bought a reed in years. Yeah, but don't worry about it. My poor clarinet is in such bad shape, and I've lost my embouchure. I can't.
Yeah, it takes a little while to get back when you've lost it.
Yeah, well, I've since moved on to violin and guitar and bass, so I just haven't had time to go back to it. In what I do, your guitar is a much more useful instrument. So I had decided not to play it for a long time, and then finally I just gave in and said, okay, it's gonna be guitar. And then I picked up the bass. Which I have fun with the bass, but I'm a bass player, so I mostly sit with the so much. It's, what a joyous way to enter into our holiday of Shabbat. And, I mean, literally, I was smiling the whole time. And there's it reminds me a little bit of the Buffo character in Commedia dell'arte. There's always just this levity in the sound, and it's and a lot of the composers seem to play it up.
Yeah, they do. That's true. They do. Yeah.
But yeah. But I felt the stride piano going with the contra. That was great.
You did a great job.
Yeah,
that
was fun. Yeah. That was fun. Well, safe journey. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I don't know.
diciendo que cuando te regreses, la plaga es de allí.
Sí, pero fuera de aquí.
No, aquí no, allí.
Y el que
fuera de aquí. Cuando te vas, ahí la plaga.
Okay, the camera looks good.
Okay, hang on just a second, let me...
The ladies have all their stuff?
Yeah.
Okay. Because they're just standing out there talking. All right.
Okay. You should be good, right there.
Is there anybody coat right there?
It's Joe.
Joe, okay. Cool.
1, 2. 1, 2, three, four. That's 2, 1, 2. Can you hear it? Hello? Can you hear it?
I don't hear much in the house, so.
Yeah, me neither. Hang on. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. 1.
2. 1, 2, 3. Can you hear it?
Yeah.